I love my job. It has everything in it. It has drama. It has love. It even has murder. And I'll show you a glimpse into my job today. Well, solve a super simple, at least I thought it was, problem, namely how to make a dialogue read-only. So, what we'll see here is a very interesting application. I have a dialogue here with a bunch of hello worlds in it. There is nothing in this dialogue. I just created it by dragging and dropping a bunch of stuff in from QDesigner. And you can see here, I can modify stuff in here as I want to. I can, this is a list and a table and a tree. I even have a tab here and, this changed the text. So pressing this button changed the text while this push button, which doesn't even have a good name. Gee, it should have called open URL or something like that. If I click that, it will somewhere on my screen load in. Oh, right there it is. The playlist for cute widgets and more. Coming up. There we are. Man, I look old. Okay, so making a read-only, that's super easy, Jesper, isn't it? You just call dialogue, if that's what your pointer to the dialogue is called, set enabled false, and that's what I did here. I can't select the text, it is grayed out. I cannot even go to the other tabs. That's not read only, that's disabled. That's whenever I want to tell the user, go away from here, there's nothing to see. But the read only is a different use case. The user cannot edit the data because he doesn't have permission to edit the data, but still, I want him to be able to go in here, click on the different tabs to see the different stuff. So set enable fault is surely not the cure. Now, what is the cure then? So the cure is just like so many other times, for example, last episode, an event filter. Let me show you the code down here. Part 3, as you can see up here, I have all the different steps in parts. If you want to go and look at the source code yourself, I'm creating an instance of this form class, which is what I just dragged together in QDesigner. I'm instantiating a read-only helper and making my form here read-only. And then I'm showing the form and the read-only helper instance here. Make read-only widget. What it does is that it runs through all of the children. And for each of the children inside there, it's installing an event filter. And the event filter is listening for the type of the event, value in, that's something that assists up here came from KD algorithm. I didn't want to make that a dependency, so I just copied the value in over here. But you should go and check out KD algorithm. There's an episode on that right here. So anyway, my event filter is testing whether the type of the event is a paint, a show, a polish, a child polish, or a timer event. And if that's the case, then it will let them through. Otherwise, it will return true, saying block everything. And let's just run the user interface now and see what it looks like. Came up here, and you can see it is indeed blocking here. It doesn't look all that good. And if I resize, it doesn't look good either, because obviously I was stealing too many events. If you want to, go to the code here and uncomment this line here, and you can see the event that is coming in while you are showing the dialogue initially. Okay, bad idea. So blocking everything except a few things seems like a bad idea. So let's turn it around. Let everything meaning every event through except those that we do not want. So obviously typing on your keyboard is likely gonna edit the dialogue, so we'll block any key press and key release event. And pressing and releasing the mouse, definitely for a push button, that would mean activating that push button or a QComboBox. And the wheel in a spin box, I could change the value with a wheel. So let's block those. And while we're at it, let's actually use the facility inside of QLineEdit and QTextEdit and a few others, namely, they do have the set read only. But not all widgets have. So those that do have, let's use that, and the others, let's block the event with an event filter. If you remember back to the beginning of this episode, I told you there would be love and murder and drama, and the drama is what I'm doing now, and the love, we already had that. Namely, the reference to The Cure, Friday I'm in Love. Oh, come on, yes, but you're so lame. Let's have a look at the user interface now, shall we? And see if it actually works. I can select stuff here. I cannot edit the user interface. I cannot edit over here. I can do fancy stuff here. No, I can't, which is expected. And now, drums. I can even switch my tabs, which I couldn't before. So how is that all of that possible? So over here at the code, what we have is make read only. Now it got slightly more complicated. If the widget that I'm trying to make read only is a line edit, then call the set read only. If it's text edit, then call set read only. If it's a plain text edit, then call set read only. Am I repeating myself? Okay, I'll fix that in the next part. Don't worry. If it is a tab widget or it's a scroll bar, because the scroll bars I also want to interact with, then don't do anything. Otherwise, iterate through all of the children, and on each of the children, call make read only recursive. One change here, I am now going just one level in, and that is not shown in this episode here, but in my own code where this comes from, I actually do have some very complex widgets where I do not want it to go through the whole child hierarchy of those widgets. So I want to block it. I'll have something up here saying, if it's my own widget, then do something and do not traverse any further. So that's what this find direct children only is doing. My event filter is now testing whether the value is one of these and blocking it. If it's a wheel event, oh, that's a difficult one. Then we'll test whether we are actually, if we have a parent, which we hopefully do, otherwise, anyway, and if that parent is inheriting from Q abstract scroll area, because my wheel event inside of Q abstract scroll area is actually scrolling the area around. And in our user interface, let's just see it again here. In our user interface, I had quite a few Q abstract scroll areas, namely my Q list view, my Q table view, and you can see I can scroll around in here, and my Q tree view down here. Nice, Jesper, but you had all that code repeated. Can you, like, do some template magic and show it to us? Okay, fair enough, I can do that. So, remember you asked for it yourself. I have my detail here. I have this has make read only. So does it have a make read only method? And, okay. And then I have down here let's not go into details. I've actually recorded another episode, and the link is right here on that stuff here, so you can watch that. But it didn't work. I thought I was smart, but it didn't work, because when I call recursively down here in here, find all the children that are QWidget subclasses. So when I have when I found a child, my static type, the type that my compiler for sure can say about this is that it's a Q widget. It doesn't know that it's a Q line edit or one of those that I'm testing for up here that has the make read only, because of all this code here is testing on the static type. So bad idea, didn't work out. Sorry. Not always is template metaprogramming the answer, and you might want to look a bit more into the code there to read all the details. It would have worked out if my types had been known statically, but when I'm traversing recursively, it doesn't. But don't worry, I actually have yet another ace up my sleeve. And that ace is the Qt meta object system. So when I have a subclass of QWidget, it is, or a subclass of QObject to be accurate, I can go and ask it for its properties. You know about properties, right? If you're a QML hacker, then obviously you know properties. That's what QML is all about. But if you're just a widget developer, you'd still know properties from the sidebar in my Qt Designer. And in there, I can actually go in my code, I can go and ask for properties. So that's what I'm doing right here. I'm going to the widget. I'm asking it for its read-only property. Do you have a read-only property? If it's valid, then the answer is yes, I do. And then I will call, I can't call setReadOnly because I still only, widget here is only a Q widget, but I can call setProperty read-only true. So if the widget, and that is the QLineEdit, the QTextEdit, the QPlainTextEdit, I'm sure more of them, has a read-only property, then I'll call the setProperty read-only. And the rest of the code now, not all that much, if it's a QLineEdit, if it's a so on. That's a pretty nice little trick. The last piece of the puzzle that I want to solve for you now is these two push buttons. They are different. This push button here, when I clicked it, it changed the content of the push button, but I do not want that. So you can might be here, I'm clicking now all I can. While this push button, labeled very nicely push button, brought up Qt, or brought up my browser to show me the Qt widgets and more episode. And that should of course still work. So how do I make that possible that one works and the other doesn't? And in the context of what we just did, you might already know the answer. The answer is of course properties again, but this time it's not a predefined property on the widgets, it's a dynamic property. And what you look at the code here, you can see that I test whether the widget has exclude from read only. And if that's the case and it's valid, that means that that property has been set. If that's the case, then just ignore it. And let me just go over to my form.ui over here and show you the button here. This is the one that should be excluded here. And you can scroll down, you can see there is a dynamic property. And let's just try and add it to this one here. I better exclude from read. I can almost remember that. The way we do it is that I choose the widget in question. I will say plus, add boolean here, exclude from read only. And I say that's a boolean. I say okay to that. And now you can see down here in my section of dynamic properties, I now have a property. And I'll let you play with this at home because I'm 100% sure that I misspelled exclude from read only. That's just me. Surprisingly hard to set read only on a dialogue and throughout the whole thing. But hopefully we learned a few things in here. We saw dynamic properties. We saw event filters, which is always a good last chance tool. Don't use it all over the place because then you'll just kill yourself. But it's a good tool for the when you're really cornered. I'm Jesper Petersen from KDAB. I hope you enjoyed this episode of Qt Widgets and More. Just one note here on the way out. This setup that I created here is not a just take the code, put it in and work all the time because there is issues. For example, how about the divider that you can have in your layout, the Q splitter? Well, that one is not handled in here, so you need to add that. And maybe some of your widgets need a bit more polishing, but it's definitely a good baseline for what you'll be doing in here. Until next time, have a great time.